Hallelujah.
Amen.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. So I would kindly ask us to greet the person on your left, on your right. Just welcome someone in the house of the Lord this morning. Yeah. Yeah. Karibuni sana. Yes. Yes, hug the hugger boys. Yeah, shake the shaker boys. Yes. Yeah. And kindly, if we can be upstanding for the reading of God's word, as it is our norm. We shall be reading in the book of Psalms 122. And the Bible says, from the NIV version, I rejoiced with those who said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Our feet are standing in your gates, Jerusalem. Jerusalem is built like a city that is closely compacted together. That is where the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, to praise the name of the Lord according to the stature given to Israel. There stand the thrones for judgment, the thrones of the house of God. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May those who love you be secure. May there be peace within your walls and security within your citadels for the sake of my friends and of all the people. I will say, peace be within you. For the sake of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek prosperity. Amen.
Amen.
You can share a word of prayer. Our Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we gather today to give you thanks and to praise your greatness. We praise your mighty works to the whole world. We praise you for your wonderful deeds. Your power is limitless. Your wisdom is unparalleled. Your grace is overwhelming. Your love is never failing. You promise that you never leave or forsake us. Therefore, Lord, we pray that you may help us to worship in truth and in the spirit. That be there anything that may hinder our worship and our praise today, Lord. We pray, Lord, that in your wrath remember mercy and forgive us all of our trespasses, Jehovah God. Holy Spirit, we welcome you in this place. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray.
Amen.
Amen. We may begin the service.
Jesus is here.
Your Father is here
to break.
Praise God, church.
Amen.
Praise the Lord once again.
Amen.
How many of you believe that God is indeed in this place? Yeah. God is in this place. Hallelujah. Turn to your neighbor and tell them God is here.
God is here.
I know He rescued my soul. His blood has covered my sin.
Shame is taken away. My pain is healed in His name. I believe. I raise a banner. Oh, my Lord has conquered the grave. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer.
Soul. His blood has covered my sin. I believe, my shame is taken away. My pain is healed in His name.
Joy of the Lord.
I'm trading my sickness. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord.
Yes,
yes, Lord, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord.
The joy of the Lord.
I'm trading my sickness.
Oh,
I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord.
We say yes.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, yes, Lord.
Yes,
Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord,
yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen.
Cast your burdens unto Jesus, for he cares for you. Cast your burdens unto Jesus, for he cares.
Hallelujah. Give the Lord a shout of praise. Yeah. Our Lord is a wonderful, merciful Savior. And that is a reminder I'd like to remind us today, that we can hope in Him and we can put our trust in Him, for He never fails us. So that is what we are declaring this morning. He is a wonderful, merciful Savior. Amen.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. And who'd have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts are hopelessly lost away. Oh, we hopelessly lost away.
Faithfully loving your own. Here in our weakness.
Here in our
weakness you find us falling before your throne. Oh, we falling before
one more time.
Your throne.
Almighty Infinite.
Almighty Infinite Father, faithfully loving your own.
Hearing our weakness.
Hearing our weakness, you find us falling before your throne. Oh, we falling before your throne. Trust.
My heart will trust in you.
My heart will trust.
Oh, my heart will trust in you.
Thank you, Lord, for we can put our trust in you. Thank you, Jesus, for you never fail. And that, Lord, we can look to you, King of glory, the author and the finisher of our faith. So, Lord, we trust you. And we just lift your name on high. There is none like you, my Father. Thank you, Jesus. We give you glory. We give you honor. None compares to you, O Father. Let's sing together.
Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word,
just to rest,
just to rest upon his promise, just to know that saves the Lord.
Jesus,
how I trust him, how I've proved him more and more. Jesus, precious Jesus. Precious Jesus, Savior, friend, and I know that thou art with
and will be with
me. Will be with me to the end.
Oh, Jesus.
Jesus, Jesus, how I trust. Yeah.
Brothers and sisters, the story of this hymn is an amazing one. I challenge you to take time and read the stories behind the hymns. This particular one was inspired by a lady who just lost the husband in a drowning accident. Recently married, had all these hopes for a beautiful life, lost the love of his life in a drowning accident. And so when she wrote those words, saying how she trusts in Jesus. Precious Jesus. There are words that came from her heart. And there are words that granted her solace and gave her a sense of peace in a very tragic time. I pray that these words will inspire us too as we go through our various challenges. Amen? Amen. Let us have our seats. Praise and worship team, thank you so much for leading us beautifully. And I know you'll be back here with that other very amazing song that you prepared for. But for now, we are going to transition briefly into a short service, which is one of the ordinances of our faith. Now, an ordinance is a Christian rite that is associated with tangible elements of worship. So for instance, water, bread, and the wine, they are emblematic. They are symbols that represent deeper realities. And these are celebrated by the Christian church. And for the Pentecostals, like ourselves, we believe in and practice two critical ordinances. These are outward and visible signs of inward graces. And these two are, number one, our Lord's table, otherwise known as the Eucharist. And we celebrate that in our church every month. And then we have baptism. And so today we are going to celebrate with one of us and witness as they as she takes her baptism. We had a longer service during the second service for a couple others who were baptized, and so for now, I want to call upon our sister, Annabelle. If you're not too far, you could just move closer. We belong to the Assemblies of God, the Kenya Assemblies of God, and we have 16 tenets of faith, 16 affirmations of the Assemblies of God denomination. And item 6, or the sixth clause of this 16, states, it's about the ordinances, and it states that the ordinance of baptism by immersion is commanded by the scriptures. All who repent and believe on Christ as Savior and Lord are to be baptized. Thus they declare to the world that they have died with Christ and that they have also been raised with him to walk in the newness of life. And we find this practiced by Christ. He underwent baptism himself. He taught it and allowed his disciples to be baptized. Matthew chapter 28, verse 19, he commands that this be done to all who believe. Mark chapter 16, verse 16. Acts chapter 10, verse 47. Romans chapter 6, verse 4. We find this precedence with the apostles and in the apostolic teachings. And that is why we practice it in this manner. And baptism is by immersion, because the word baptism literally comes from the Greek word that means immersion. And that is why, as a denomination, we believe one needs to be immersed wholly in water for this ordinance to be fully done. And so at this point, I'm going to call upon our lead pastor, Bishop Tony, to just come. Yeah, as we get this set. Okay. And I will call upon our sister, Annabel Cheruto, to join us here. Let's appreciate her as she comes. Annabel has gone through the classes requisite for you to qualify to undergo this. And so,
so, Annabel, what does this mean to you?
I am accepting what I have already accepted from the inside, Christ.
Amen. According to your confession of faith, Annabel, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Let's appreciate our pastor as well. Bwana asifiwe sana. And so I call upon all of us as a church, in case you have not been baptized, we encourage that you consider signing up for baptism. Every so often we will call upon you, the announcements will be made, and we will prepare you sufficiently. There'll be classes you'll need to be part of for a time, and then we will set the dates for the baptism. Kwa hivyo, look out for that, and in case you've not been baptized, kindly consider being part of the next baptism. Bwana asifiwe sana. I'll call upon Jambi to take it over from here.
God is good. God is good. And all the time. And that's his nature. Amen. He never changes. He remains the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Amen. I'd like to take this opportunity to welcome you into the house of the Lord. It is good to see you from up here. You all look wonderful. Why don't you turn to somebody behind you, in front of you, next to you, someone you did not come with, and welcome them into the house of the Lord. You can shake their hand, give them a high five, compliment them. You could be the first person they spoke to this morning. I hope now you feel welcome. I'd like to extend a warmer welcome to those who are fellowshipping with us for the very first time. Any visitors fellowshipping with us for the very first time, kindly by a show of hand, we'd like to acknowledge you and to welcome you to the river of God. I see hands at the back. I request that you please stand so that we may all see you and welcome you into the river of God church. Please do stand. We have a number at the back. I'll request that you remain standing so that we may welcome you the River of God way. And I'll ask the church to join me, and let's welcome our visitors today.
There's a welcome here, there's a welcome here, there's a Christian welcome here. There's a welcome here, there's a welcome here. There's a Christian welcome here. God loves you and I love you, and that's the way it should be. God loves you and I love you, and that's the way it should be.
You may have your seats. We are glad that you chose to fellowship with us. We ask at the end of the service, go to your door to your left.
You'll meet a hospitality team. What they've put in your hand, don't be in a hurry to read it now or to fill it in now. You'll do so at the end of the service. If you're looking for a home church, karibu nyumbani. If you do have a church, kindly take our regards. Perhaps you're watching us online and this is the first time you're tuned in and you'd like to fellowship with us physically. We're on Ojiju Road and you're most welcome to fellowship with us. As we say, we are a home church and we are a family church. Is that true? Is that true?
Yes.
Yes. And when one of us comes back, don't we celebrate and thank the Lord for that? Isn't that so? Mm-hmm. So this morning I have the pleasure of welcoming back Ambassador Parashina. Please stand. Him and his family. You can stand with your family so that we may see you. Please let's welcome them this morning. Actually, kindly come. He's a very special man. And I'd like him to greet us and to tell us about himself briefly. Let's welcome them. Let's appreciate them. You know, he told me, just mention, don't embarrass. So, sir.
Thank you. Bwana asifiwe.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I'll allow my wife to go first. That is not just diplomatic, but it's also African.
Bwana asifiwe.
Amen.
It's been 3 years since I was here. It's so nice to be back home. It's nice to take part in the worship and praise. It doesn't happen the same way in other places. So it was heartwarming for me to just take part in that. And I want to thank this church through our pastor, just to say that we have felt your love and your prayers. The last week before we came over was so tight. I'm sure I told you more about it. And I remember I listened to Nyawira preach the other weekend when I was in a bomb shelter. It was so tight. And it's an honor to know that you've been praying for us and we are safe. And it's good to be back home. Bwana asifiwe. Amen.
Thank you. As my wife has said, it's always a pleasure to be here. I was here last week, last Sunday, and many times I've come here, I've come alone. I think Reverend Carol knows that I've been coming here, and many questions have been posed on me. Where are the others? They are all here. The other three are in the Sunday school. Sean, Shanice, and Sheena. Forgive me if I forget their names. This one is Israeli. She's called Sherin. When we left, she was not there. This is her first time to be here in church. So she's still struggling to understand the environment, but she'll catch up. Otherwise, it's been a pleasure. Thank you for your prayers. We did our vetting on Wednesday. And it went on well, and thank God for the favor, for the strength. Actually, I was saying if I didn't come here on Sunday for prayers, to be prayed for by the church, I don't know whether I will have found that grace. So actually, I left the church convinced that the Lord has spoken. And I believe that as we head to the next station, and because I believe we'll be confirmed, I know the Lord has gone before us. This is a mission and something that he knew before. And I know we'll accomplish greater things by his grace. Amen. Thank you, and God bless you all.
What perhaps he hasn't said, when he was in Israel, he was the Deputy High Commissioner. And now his new assignment is the High Commissioner in Nigeria, from Kenya to Nigeria. So we bless the Lord, and I'll ask Reverend Carol to please pray.
Okay.
Now my boss has come, so I'll ask him to please come and pray. But we thank God for you. We thank God for that you're safe. It was very scary. And we thank God for addition, for multiplying. The Bible clearly says, go and multiply. Those who have ears, they'll be charged through conversion and birth. Amen. So I want to pray for you in this new assignment that God will continue to give you grace, that God will help you to stand, that we won't see you on, was it CNN, Gold Mafia? That you will not get into all those mashananigans. And that God's grace will keep you in this new assignment. Amen. We thank God for you, and it's such a privilege to be here. So just ask Pastor Tony to please come and pray.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Remember on Sunday I asked him, where are the people? Yes. When they left, she wasn't there. Mm-hmm. Did he say that?
Yes. Yeah.
So we are growing by?
Numbers.
And by? Conversion. So she's never been to River of God. This is her first time. So can we sing her our visitor song?
There's a welcome here. There's a welcome here. There's a Christian welcome here. There's a welcome here. There's a welcome here. There's a Christian welcome here. God loves you and I love you and that's the way it should be. God loves you and I love you and that's the way it should be.
Hallelujah. We value whether they are little kids or they are adults. We value them the same. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, thank you for the gift of life and safety. And thank you for the opportunity to serve. And in this season where you're raising your own to serve Almighty God, Jehovah, in the name of Jesus Christ, we commit them to this new assignment. And we pray for your favor, your grace, and your wisdom to lead your people, Almighty God. Stand on behalf of this nation. Father, they will fly the flag of Christ high. Oh God, in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray that you will increase them. I pray that you will bless them. I pray that you will use them. Preserve and order their steps. And I pray for courage. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
As we've said, we're a family church, and families celebrate each other. So this morning, as we continue to celebrate, I'd like us to celebrate those who had their birthdays this past week. Pastor Caro is particularly excited. And I'd like anyone who had their birthdays this past week, kindly by a show of hand. Don't even show your hand, please stand. We are celebrating the Lord as we celebrate you. I'll mention a few. I can see Lowena Gadoni there. Someone is standing behind me. We have Sydney. Sydney Mulunda. I can tell why Pastor Caro was particularly excited. Because TJ's birthday was on Friday. So that's also her birthday by extension. That's why she's excited. So TJ Kiama, Terence Monene, Mahodo Moturi, whose birthday was yesterday. Jemima is calm and collected. We have Kyle Baraka and Catherine Mukami. Let's celebrate these wonderful people.
Happy birthday, dear member. Happy birthday, dear members. Happy birthday, dear members. Happy birthday, dear members. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear members. May you have blessed many more. May you have blessed many more. May you have blessed many more. Blessed many more. May you have blessed many more. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear members.
You may have your seats. So let us bow our head for a word of prayer, as we pray for the birthdays and the offering. And let's pray. Almighty and everlasting Father, we give you glory, Lord, because you're the Alpha and the Omega in our lives, Almighty Father. We worship you this morning and exalt your holy name, Father, because truly there is none like you, Lord. We thank you, Father, for your mercies that are new each and every morning, Almighty God. And even this day, thank you, Lord, for your mercies that you've bestowed upon us. Father, this morning we come with humble hearts and with thanksgiving in our hearts, Almighty Father, for those who celebrated their birthdays, Almighty God. Lord, the gift of life is one that we truly, truly cherish, and we bless your name, Almighty Father. We thank you for each and every one of them who celebrated their birthdays, Almighty Father. Lord, we pray that this year they may be filled with favor, Almighty God, that they will continue to enjoy the goodness, your goodness, Lord, in this land of the living, Almighty Father. May they continue to know that you have good plans for their lives, Almighty Father. And Lord, may you meet their heart's desires, O Lord. Bless their coming in and their going out, Almighty Father. Lord, we thank you once again for each and every one of them. Lord, this morning, as we seated gathered to hear your word, Lord Jesus, we thank you, Father, that we can even gather together. And we're not even worried of any wars, Lord Jesus, or some are. But Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to hear your word. Lord, we ask that you'll quieten our hearts and our minds, that, Father, we may be receptive of your word. That, Lord, we shall not live the same way we came in, but your word shall be alive and active in our hearts, Almighty God. Father, as we prepare to give our tithes and offerings, Lord, this is just but a portion of what you've given unto us. And Lord, we give back saying thank you because you've sustained us, Almighty Father. Lord, we know that there are some of us who may not be able to give for one reason or the other, Almighty God, with the financial situation going on in the country, Lord Jesus. We pray that, Lord, they may experience you as Jehovah Jireh, our provider, who is a miracle worker and who is still faithful, Almighty God, in times of need, Almighty Father, in times of plenty, Lord. We ask that, Lord, you will meet them at their point of need, Father. Lord, even we thank you for our visitors, for ordering their steps here. Lord, we ask that you will bless them, Almighty Father, whether they have a home church, and if they're looking for one, we thank you for ordering their steps here. We thank you, Lord, even for your presence this morning. We invite your continued presence throughout the service, Lord, and we come against any form of destruction, Lord Jesus, whether we come with heavy hearts or with hearts of thanksgiving, that we say thank you, Lord, for what you've done. And Lord, even those of us who come with hearts, with heavy hearts, we pray that, Lord, you'll meet each and every one of them at their point of need. We give you glory and honor, for in Jesus' name we do pray and believe. Amen. Amen.
Welcome to the River of God Church, where we strive to be a life-transforming church that proclaims the kingdom of God. Our mission is to reach people for Christ, refresh believers by the word of God, and refine believers for good works, releasing them to transform the world. Join us in worshiping the Lord with our tithes and offerings. You can use M-Pesa services with our paybill number 529-653, account name, tithe, or offering. Or you can use Standard Chartered banking services with the account number 01-02-09-46-98-900. Upcoming mission to Ichamara Mukurueni in Nyeri County is scheduled for November 23rd to 25th, 2023. This mission will primarily focus on providing eye care services. We are in need of volunteers, including opticians, nurses, and evangelists. If you are interested in joining this mission and making a difference, please register at the information desk. Your participation will be greatly appreciated. We are pleased to announce the following wedding bands. Nikita Das weds Arjun R.J. Raval. If anyone has any legal reason why this too shouldn't be joined in holy matrimony, we kindly request you to contact any of our pastors. The Children's Ministry will host a camp in Naivasha from November 21st to 25th for children aged 7 to 13. The cost is 7,500 shillings per person. Parents are encouraged to complete the payment for their children as soon as possible to secure a spot for them at the camp. To all young professionals, join us on November 4th for an unforgettable adventure at Ngong Hills. It's just 500 shillings for a day of excitement, hiking, and camaraderie with like-minded young adults. To register and find out more details, visit the information desk. Don't miss out. To our visitors, we are so glad that you chose to visit with us today. We invite you to join us for an unforgettable experience, get to know us, and enjoy fellowship with us. After the service, please proceed to the room marked visitors where our hospitality team will be waiting on you.
Kila ninapofanya kazi kwa uwezo wangu misiwezi. Ingawa nimejitahidi kusonga mbele kusonga, lakini misi babaiki, kwani wewe unami. Mamlaka yote duniani ni yako, hakuna jambo usiloliwe.
Uliweza.
Nguvu zako baba tumeshinda.
Tumeshinda.
Imani yangu ipo kwako wewe.
Ewe Bwana.
Nami nitajificha chini yako.
Wewe Mwana.
Wewe waweza.
Wewe waweza. Wewe waweza Bwana. Wewe waweza.
Hakuna jambo usiloliwe.
Tuliweza.
Kwa nguvu zako baba tumeshinda.
Tumeshinda.
Imani yangu ipo kwako wewe.
Wewe Bwana.
Nami nitajificha chini yako.
Wewe Bwana.
Wewe waweza.
Wewe waweza.
Wewe waweza. Kulinganishwa nawe baba.
Unaweza Bwana.
Na nguvu zako hazina kikomo baba.
Unaweza.
Wewe waweza.
Wewe waweza.
Wewe waweza.
Wewe waweza.
God is able. Praise the Lord. God is able. God made a solemn vow to Abraham. God made a solemn vow to who? To Abraham. He promised Abraham that I will give you this land from the Euphrates to Egypt. Abraham wouldn't fight for it, wouldn't buy it, he would give it to him, period. It was just between the two of them. Cut the animals, split them, only God walked through. In Psalm 122 and verse 6, the Bible says, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Is there a benefit to it? I want you to go read that benefit for yourself. Am I concerned by the Palestinian children who are used as a human shield, innocent children dying? Breaks my heart. I stopped watching. Bloodshed is ugly. When God made the foundations of this earth, did he know that this would happen? Was God aware? Yet he still said, pray for the peace of Jerusalem, even in this season. The world has drawn battle lines for and against Israel. Choose a side. The world has drawn battle lines. Even nations have drawn battle lines. So the world is divided smack right in the middle. True? So even you choose a side. Choose a side. But for me, that promise, that solemn promise that God gave Abraham, I am reminding God of that promise. The same way I remind him of the promise when I'm sick that he promised he will heal. When I'm going through a difficult time, I promise that he promised that he would be with me through the shadows and the valleys of death. Even as I'm reminding him of that, I remind him of the promise to Abraham, who God calls his friend. God, remember the promise to your friend. Remember that promise in Jesus' name. This morning, we're going to be praying for parents who have candidates and a few other things. And I know it's stressful. When your children are doing an exam, even you, you're a candidate. So I want to invite all those who are sitting for their exams this year. There's Standard 6, there's Class 8, there's Form 4. The other day, 2 or 3 weeks ago, there was also Standard 3. We are an exam nation. Any parents who are, their children are sitting for the national exam this year, why don't you come here? Let me pray for you. Where are the candidates? Pardon? Oh, they're in their class. So the parents will stand on their behalf. Those who are here, come. The candidates who are here, come. But the parents, stand on behalf of your children. This way. Thank you. So the children come in front. The parents move behind a bit. Let the children who are here stand here. It's an exam and it's important. But it doesn't equal to your life, young people. True? Yeah. And God, we are praying today that God would fight for you, that God would go before you, that God will bring to remembrance that which you have studied. Because everything you see on that document, you've seen it before. That God will bring it to remembrance. Amen. The rest of us, why don't we stretch our hands towards these dear ones? Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray for everyone here. I pray for these students and the parents who are standing on behalf of these students. Father, I pray that, Lord, you will bring to remembrance that which they have learned. I pray for calmness of spirit. Jehovah, in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray that they will not panic. I pray for clarity of mind, even as they write the answers. Jehovah, in the name of Jesus Christ, we believe in you, O Lord, that you will come through for these children. Father, I pray that during this season that they will not get sick. Father, remember them. I pray that when they go to sleep tonight, Father, they will sleep. They will not be anxious through the night. That their minds will relax and rest. I pray for the parents that there will be no anxiety. I pray, Almighty God, that there will be no pressure, that there will be kindness of words, even towards the children. Oh God Almighty, in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray for good weather, even during these days when they are sitting for the exams. Father, we dedicate these children to you. May you fight for those of the household of faith. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. May God go before you all. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. When one hurts, we all hurt. I can see Judy Manoj is here. So Judy and Manoj, if you would come. Judy's mother passed away. Judy's actually a pastor. Both the dad and mom are ministers of the gospel. So the mom passed away and we went for the burial in Unguja. This is Judy and that's Manoj. And then we have Blossom and Sadiq. Let me invite them to come. Blossom's sister passed away. Blossom's sister, Chana. She's been living in India, and she passed away last week. She's been unwell for some time, and let me ask all the pastors who are here, pastors, wives, all the ministry leaders, if you would come at this point, just lay your hands over these dear ones here. Hallelujah. I think the worst thing when you are bereaved is to be alone. I think it's the worst thing that can ever happen to you because death already is painful, but being alone is even worse. And I keep encouraging us as a church, reminding us that mourning starts after the burial. Because before the burial, you're so busy, you don't even have the opportunity to process. You're still in shock. And then you're busy preparing and running around all over the place. But it's after that you need the most help. So if we can make time and have the culture of visiting people after the burial, so that they can just know that they are loved. You don't even need to say anything. Just being there, the ministry of presence. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I thank you for these two families. Thank you for Judy. I thank you for Blossom, Lord, as they mourn. That, Lord, you will be their encouragement and their strength. Oh, God Almighty, Father in heaven, in the name of Jesus Christ, comfort them with your mighty comfort. Comfort them, Jehovah. Comfort them, Father. And go before them. Minister to their hearts. And speak to them and wipe the tears that we cannot see. the pain and the questions only you can deal with, at Jehovah, because you are God. So we submit them to you, and we pray that, Lord, it is well and it shall be well with your soul. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We love you and we are here for you. Amen. Bless you. This is the building month, and we have speakers in the building committee, and today we have an architect speaking to us. Hallelujah. We've had engineers, surveyors, interior decorators, professors, and now an architect. So we'll see the world in the architecture's eyes. But before I invite the architect, let me ask if there is anyone here who has a need. You have a need and you're saying, God, I need you to help me here. You have a prayer need and you'd like somebody to pray with you. Just come to this altar and we'll pray together. And by the way, it doesn't matter how many times you come. The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 5:17, pray without ceasing. Pray without, you pray until it happens. The audacity of prayer. In Jesus' name. Because we serve a God who answers prayer. Father, in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, I thank you for this altar. The Lord, we can meet with you because you promise that where two or three are gathered, there in their presence, you are. And so today, Almighty God, in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray that you would come and minister to your people. Minister to your children, because we, O Lord, have come to the altar to meet our Father in heaven. Our Father who is able. Our Father who can. Our Father who has done, who is doing, and who will do. Jehovah, in the name of Jesus, we believe because we know in our hearts there's a witness that our God is on our side. And our God will come and meet with us. And that's why this afternoon, Lord, on our knees, Almighty God, on this altar, we are believing and trusting that our God has heard our prayer. Because you are the God who does the impossible. Father, we are here because we cannot do it on our own. But you can do it for us. Your word reminds us that we who are evil know how to give good gifts to our children. That when they ask for bread, we don't give them stones. When they ask for fish, we don't give them snakes. How much more you who is holy will give us good things. So Lord, this afternoon I pray that which these dear ones have asked or petitioned before thee, that you would meet them, my God and my Father. So I dedicate them back to you, Father, because we dedicate ourselves to thee, O Lord, because you are God, our Father, and you will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Receive from the Lord. As they go back to sit, on the 4th, which is on a Saturday coming, a few years ago, there was a little girl who came to this church. And every time the mother would leave church and she hadn't said hi to the pastor, she would really cry. And the mother would have to bring her back to my office to say hi. And she became my friend. We were friends. I hadn't seen the family in some time. So as the church is growing, sometimes you don't notice, you don't see some people. So after some time, I asked, where is this family? I don't see them anymore. Or maybe they come, it's just me who doesn't see. So one of the ushers told me that they don't come to church anymore because they have a special needs child at home. and the help goes on leave on Sunday. So they don't come to church because the mother has to take care of their special needs child. I felt like someone had taken a knife and stabbed my heart. This little girl can't come to church because her sister is sick. And I asked myself, what are we doing as a church? And right there and then, I purposed in my heart, we shall have a special needs service here. In the new building, one entire floor is for special needs. We have a special needs floor. We have very many volunteers here who we continuously have started training them so that they will serve on that floor. I know when you, as a family, when you have a family member who has special needs, the stigma in Africa is that it's demonic. Special needs is not necessarily demonic. It's just a medical condition. It's a medical condition. There is room for them here, a river of God. There is room for special needs individuals, a river of God. So Saturday, coming Saturday at 11, all the people who come to River of God who have a special needs individual at home, I want to have lunch with you. Because where there's no feedback, there's no growth. I want to hear, before we assume this is how we should serve you, why don't you give us feedback on what you need from us as a church? So me and Pastor Caro will be waiting for you here at 11 o'clock on Saturday to hear. We have lunch and let's talk. Talk to us. Talk to us. The building is almost done. Let's put our ducks in a row. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Let me invite in architect Githaiga to come and bring the word. These guys are a family. They were here at 6, the building committee team, to support each other. I was envious. So welcome, my brother.
Asante.
And I'm sure you will make the relevant introductions.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Let's pray. Father, I pray for your servant. I pray, Almighty God, that you touch his lips as you touched Isaiah's. I pray that you prepare our hearts to be tender to receive from you. And Lord, this afternoon, we know that you have a word for us. We have given our offerings, receive them, for they come from a place of gratitude and obedience to your instructions. Lord, even that which we have sung as worship, Father, may it be a sweet sound, and forgive us where we've sinned against thee. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Bless you.
Good morning, church. Or it's good afternoon. My name is Mwangi Githaiga, and I'm saved this morning. I have the unique honor of being here. I am a married man. My lovely wife has accompanied me today. And I am a father to two lovely girls. I'm also an architect, and we run a farm with my wife, who is also an architect. Here in Westlands, and I serve in the building committee as a technical consultant. And that is how I ended up here. My wife is here. I think wanataka usimame. All right. So as I start, I want to add a disclaimer that prior to this morning, I have never preached before, ever. And I'll give backstory. So sometime last year, Kariba, who we are working with, is in the building committee. He asked me, come help in the building committee, but in a technical role. And I asked, what does that entail? Means during building meetings, you just show up on Zoom call for 15, 20 minutes and help with any technical matters. Kasema, hiyo naezana kabisa. I can do that one. How it moved from there to preaching on Sunday. And he forgot to mention that part, because if he had, I would have done like Jonah, opposite direction. So now I truly understand what Jonah was going through. I think Emily in the previous spoke about Jonah, and me, I understood. So during that building committee meeting, towards the end, Kariba now reads the list of people, the days they are preaching and the people. And my name was last for 29th today, and I thought he was joking. So I looked across the room. I can't say anything because prof is there, pastor is there, but I'm giving him dagger eyes. I'm like, Buddha, I thought we are brothers. It wasn't a joke, because prof was serious, pastor was serious. So also, the same meeting where Emily and Marcy were also walengishiwa bompia. So they were in shock. People started raising their objections. Me, I added mine. I said, I have never preached before. I have no theological training whatsoever. I am the youngest person there. I can't say I have decades of Christian experience. So if there is a list of building committee members, I should be at the bottom, and you need to work your way down before you select me. So I put forward a very good case. And Pastor Tony, to his credit, listened to me. He didn't interrupt. He said, Kanyamaza kanisikiza. Alafu at the end, he just said, don't worry, my brother. We will pray for you. So there's no comeback to that when your pastor says that. But as I was driving home, I was thinking about it. I'm like, no. Wait, you can't throw someone in the deep end and then say, I will pray for you. Angalau mgenianjizisha children's ministry with the three-year-olds for 5 minutes, and then maybe over 20 years, I can work my way here. So the next day, I really gombanishad Kariba, and just like Matthew, I really made noise at him. And because being the person that I am, the Christian that I am, unajua kila mtu anajielewa, you know your strengths, your weaknesses, you know where you can contribute in church. And this came because in my early days when I got saved, which is not long ago, by the 2013 there, one of the sermons I listened to was by John MacArthur. And he was talking to young believers. And he was saying, there are so many things you might feel you are expected to do, but he narrowed it down and explained it in a very nice way, which I will share today. And he was explaining that life as we know it here on earth is like the Titanic. This ship is going down. Your work as a Christian is to get onto the lifeboat that is Jesus Christ. Everything else ni siasa. You don't start fighting for better positions, better rooms in the ship, far away from the water. You don't start trying to go down to fix the engine or talk to the captain and say this and this. Your point is to get yourself and your family to the lifeboat that is Jesus. And in essence, narrowed down, but Tony can do a better job. But in essence, this means loving God, seeking Him, seeking to follow His word, being prayerful, and being part of a believing Christian community. So hizo zote naangalia, check, check, check. Sasa believing community, how do I support? And part of being a man ni kujielewa, you know your strengths, your weaknesses, what works for you, what doesn't. So me, I'm an introverted person. So I don't have the social skills most of you do. So I'm not someone for hospitality, crusades, ministry, outreach. That was not my forte. But I said, I have skills, God-given skills, that I can use to the benefit of the community. So I help churches when it comes to building. And so even now, we are, together with my lovely wife, we have designed and building two churches here in Nairobi. One is PCF Green Church in Runda and Karura Community Chapel in Limuru Road. And then, tukishafanya hiyo, nasema, I am good, I am set, I have done my part. No, we don't go beyond here. So when I was asked to speak, I was like, hey, this is against my character, my background. You know, even when in church, I don't sit at the back, I don't sit at the front, in the middle, amongst the masses. Because I figure, in my view, Christianity, you know, there are, if it's a marathon, there are akina Eliud Kipchoge, ikuna wenyewe, which is akina Tony here, and Carol, Pastor Tony. And then theirs is the Golden Mansions. And speaking now, having prepared a sermon, which has been very stressful this past week, I have a lot of respect. Doing this 52 times a year, together with everything else, is a lot of work. I understand fully why Jonah ran away. So the way I see it in heaven, as Paul says, people will get golden mansions. Me, I'm not even campaigning for those ones. I'm campaigning for a small house inside. I don't, since I know the people, I know Akina Eliud. During the day, I can ask for a cup of tea. Can I visit? I enjoy. And then I'll walk back in those golden streets to my small house, and I'll be happy. I'll be content. As I sleep, I'm like, I made it. Sichomeki mimi, I am here. So in summary, prior to this month, if anyone had asked, I would be 100% sure I would never stand in a place like this. But now see my life. I'm adding all of those disclaimers because the other people in the building committee, even though they were new at it, have done an excellent job. I hope to do the same. But if I fumble a bit, mtanielewa tafadhali. I already fumbled a bit for service. I was told short sermon, and I actually made it short. I think I shocked people here. It was very short. So this time round, I'm actually timing myself so that I actually don't make it a sermonette. And you have a gap of 20 minutes you don't know what to do with. All right. So I will start. Today's word that I'm sharing is a sacred place. And I'm here to basically, we were asked to speak from our experience. And I'm here to give both perspective and context to building a place of worship, building a sacred place. Building a church, a temple, is a work comparable to no other. It is not building a school. It's not building apartments there in Roysambu. These days they call it Kikuyu Gothic architecture with landlord cream walls. It is serious business. It is, how do I say this? It is a work that transcends us, and I'll get a bit into that a bit later. This is work that cannot be derived from contemporary form, and that means it can't be derived from whatever classical or modern styles that are there, and it can't be from a certain aesthetic doctrine that is in vogue or in fashion, but a church building is a work in its own right, bound to its own meaning, and exhausted therein. And for that, to give further context to that, I will talk about All Saints Cathedral, which all of us know and you've entered. It is an old building. It was conceptualized in 1915, and they broke ground, or the foundation stone was laid in 1917, and they finished it progressively, 1924, 1934, and finally 1952. That was a 37-year journey, and it took a lot of time and a lot of resources to get there. And if you go there today, that building, they have not changed anything because they did a solid job on it. Every single person who was present at groundbreaking, even if they were a baby, is dead. It's long gone. Wameenda kwa Yesu. But the church has outlived them. It has transcended them. People, many generations of Christians have worshipped there and continue to worship there and will continue to worship there. When that church was being built, us black folk, we were not Africans, we were not allowed in that church. But the story is very different now. So the work that we are doing today as River of God, building the Foundation Ministry Center behind us for the kids, the teens and the young adults, and all the work that will happen here to make it larger and add an upper gallery is work that will outlive us. 100 years from now, in 2123, I don't think any of us will still be here, for sure, I think. Okay, maybe some, but most of us. And there'll be a different Tony leading this church. There'll be a different Pastor Carol. You, where you're seated, a different Christian will be seated there, worshiping, believing. And so this, it is an honor and an opportunity for us, this generation of 2023, to be able to gift all future generations a church, and a good church at that. To take you back to how much these church buildings will outlive us, I will take you back to All Saints Cathedral. At the entrance on the right, there's a stone from the Abbey of Lindisfarne, which was a church. It was a small abbey for monks off the north coast of England that was established in 640 AD, more than 1,300 years ago. But there's a piece of that stone. Those monks, I'm sure, in their wildest dreams, never thought a piece of it would end up deep in Africa. On the left of that stone, of the entrance, is a stone also from St. Paul's Cathedral in London, of which the original church was established in 604 AD, again. And the current church that is there was finished in 1710. So, looking at that whole scheme of things, 200, 300 years from now, this building will still be there. Who knows what Christians will be, different Christians will be there, but they'll be there. And it is our honor to be able to do this. And so it leads to my point that we are not just building a roof, walls and a roof, but a sacred place. And so to now get into it, I will take us to, because I'm not going to open a verse and like illuminate some great theological preaching. I will take you to see the work of the Lord in terms of the churches or the temples that he commissioned through my eyes and through the eyes of an architect. And I'll just start off by explaining, let's say, if you take this place, if you give an architect or an engineer floor plans, they can be able to read them. They can be able to know what works in this space, what doesn't work, what compromises were required to make it work, what was the budget. There's a lot that one can illuminate just from looking at a floor plan. Similarly, in my own life, when I see humanity and what God has designed, I don't like see a father, which he is. I see a master architect at work whose skills, abilities, aspirations far exceed my own to the point of almost being incomprehensible. And I approach learning from the Bible as an apprentice to a master builder. I come in with awe and reverence, eager to learn, eager to grow at the feet of the master. From the first words of Genesis, We see a creator, a master builder, who creates a universe from nothing. And we can tell that God is a God of order, a God of purpose, and a God obsessed with the most minute of details. So today we shall be looking at God as an architect, and we shall be primarily looking at the worship spaces he designed. This is the tabernacle and the temple, and how they relate to our relationship with him. So at this point, I'll ask us to kindly rise for today's Bible readings. So today's Bible readings, there are three of them. To give context, we are reading what God said as he commissioned the work of the Lord, the work of the temple at various times throughout the Old Testament. The first one is Exodus 25:8, where the Lord is speaking to Moses as he gives him the instructions for building the tabernacle. So if you read Exodus 25:8, it says, "Then have them make a sanctuary for me, and I will dwell among them." Then we will jump to God when he was instructing Solomon when he was building the temple. This is in 1 Kings 6, 11 to 13. And I will read for you. "The word of the Lord came to Solomon. As for this temple you are building, if you follow my decrees, observe my laws and keep all my commands and obey them, I will fulfill through you the promise I gave to David your father. And I will live among the Israelites, and I will not abandon my people Israel." The next reading is when the Israelites were rebuilding the temple, and we'll go towards the end of the Old Testament in Haggai chapter 1, verse 5 to 8. Now, this is what the Lord Almighty says, "Give careful thought to your ways. You have planted much, but harvested little. You eat, but never have enough. You drink, but never have your fill. You put on clothes, but you are not warm. You earn wages only to put them in a purse with holes in it. This is what the Lord Almighty says, give careful thought to your ways. Go up into the mountains and bring down timber and build my house, so that I may take pleasure in it and be honored, says the Lord." You may have your seats. So from those readings, you can see his first point of that he points out to the Israelites is, you build it and I will dwell in it and I will take pleasure in it. And so it wasn't... he later goes on in detail, but that is a point, that the Lord will dwell in the house. And that's what makes it a sacred space. So the first one we are going to look at is the tabernacle. Now, for context, the Israelites are now out of Egypt, and they are in the desert. And Moses comes down from the mountain, and there are instructions for him on the place of worship. And this, God didn't say it after kamba pale, whatever extra cloth you have, later. He gave detailed instructions for how everything was going to come together. For 7 entire chapters in Exodus, from Exodus 25 to Exodus 31, God gives Moses detailed instructions for the building of the tabernacle and everything in it. This includes the Ark of the Covenant, the table, the lampstand, the altar of burnt offerings, the courtyard, the priestly garments, even the oil that they were using. He gave, put this, put this, put this. Everything was detailed. Sio kubahatisha, or whatever Moses felt was the way to go. There were instructions to it. He also chose Bezalel and Oholiab and filled them with the Spirit of God and skills in all kinds of crafts, so as to make all that has been commanded. So from that we can see that these plans were not generalizations or suggestions, but they were specific in the type of material they were going to use. And you should take the time to just read. You're specific on the type of materials. They were very specific on the measurements and where each item was going to be, and the ornamentation that would be there, everything down to the priestly garments and which jewel would be where. Which tells us that God is concerned with the materiality of our human experience as much as he is with our spiritual experience. And the tabernacle functioned as a primary symbol of God's presence in the world and among his people in the wilderness. So how the tabernacle worked was it was not a permanent place of worship, because the Israelites were on the move for all those years in the desert. So even the tabernacle could be pulled apart, put on camels, carts, and it moves with them to the next place, and then they erect it again. That would be, if we think of it in our own personal experience, it would be like, today you came to church, God went with you, in the car seated, mnaenda na yeye. Then he comes. You come to church, he's there with you. You go back home, he has a house in your estate, and you can say that is God's presence, which is very different from how we do it now, where there's an actual physical place of worship that we go to. And it was a very unique living experience, I must say, because if this is the encampment and the tabernacle is somewhere in the middle, God is literally there. You can see the cloud of fire or the clouds. You would walk on the straight and narrow because we went to Yuko. As in, it's not like Uko up in the heavens. He is there. You can see him. It was a very unique experience because, and it highlights God's immanence. Immanence comes, basically means to dwell within. That whole experience with the tabernacle was God being with his people there as they moved in that desert, guiding them, providing for them. And the tabernacle was not an elaborate 8-story sort of tent. It was a low-lying structure, just like the tents they were moving with. And it didn't stand out, both in design or scale. It was very intimate and immanent. So now, when the Israelites finally moved to the promised land, crossed the River Jordan, fought hard to occupy Israel and move the people out of there, they eventually established a final place of worship. David had wanted to do it, but God said he had blood on his hands, and it was his son who had the opportunity and privilege to do it, and this was Solomon. I also always point out that I discovered much later, so I always find it to be a great revelation, is that the day they crossed the River Jordan, God stopped providing for them. He said, now feed off the land. It was now they had transitioned to a new, instead of daily dependence on manna, they were now out there claiming their promised land. Now, when we go to the temple, Solomon had the privilege and opportunity to build an elaborate and permanent temple in the capital of that time, which was Jerusalem, still the capital now, actually. So, just as with the tabernacle, God gave detailed instructions for how the temple would be built. And you can find this in 1 Kings chapter 5 to 8 and in 2 Chronicles 2 to 7. There is a significant difference between how the tabernacle was designed and how the temple was designed. The temple was much larger in scale and in volume. It was an outstanding building amidst all the other buildings of in Jerusalem. It was an outstanding structure. If you looked at the skyline of Jerusalem, you'd be able to point out and say, that's the temple, because it rose up above all the other buildings. The worshippers were welcomed with a sense of awe. And this was highlighting the transcendence of God. Transcendence here meaning supremacy or superiority of God. And this was achieved by the virtue of when you entered that worship space, you the scale of it was so massive you felt small. And it theologically communicated that God was the superior other. You were not in question of the supremacy of God when you're in those spaces. Now, these two designs of the church, of the temples, the tabernacle, which was about immanence and dwelling within, and the temple, which was about awe and the supremacy of God, were all brought together in the life that is Jesus Christ. The immanence of the tabernacle and the transcendence of the temple, while seemingly two conflicting themes, were expressed fully in the life of Jesus Christ, and I will endeavor to explain that part. Everything that Israel stood for, because they had a way of worship until the time Christ came, with the priests, with the offerings and the sacrifices, with the rituals, all of this, all were redefined by the presence, by the person and the work of Jesus Christ. Jesus was part of the Trinity. So to explain the immanence part, the dwelling within, is that God took human form and dwelt with the people, walked with the people, talked to them, reached out to them. It's always pointed out how in the wedding that he turned water into wine, he wasn't a very serious guy. He's like, Mkweni, this is a, I am here, be like this. He actually made wine so that guys can have fun. It was a social event, a celebration, a wedding. And he was among us, hence the immanence part. But at the same time, he was God, and he was there at creation, and offered himself as a sacrifice to atone for all our sins. And those two parts, that immanence and that transcendence, moved us from temples that were concrete and stone to a living temple that is physical flesh and blood, that was Jesus Christ. And now in our turn, as believing Christians, we are also considered living temples, just like Jesus Christ. Upon foretelling his death, Jesus comforts the disciples by telling them that another counselor is coming. In John 16, verse 7, he goes as far as to say, it is to their advantage that he leaves so that the counselor can come. And that counselor, as we all know, is the Holy Spirit. The same Holy Spirit that came to the disciples in a mighty way when they waited in Jerusalem is the same Holy Spirit that dwells in us now. The same Holy Spirit that is a part of the Trinity, was there at the moment of creation, that is eternal and holy, dwells within us. According to 1 Corinthians 3:16, chapter 3, 16 to 17, it says, don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple, and that God's Spirit dwells in your midst? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person. For God's temple is sacred, and you together are that temple. And that is really the crux of my message today, that as much as we are building a temple for the Lord in this new dispensation, as Christians, we are the living temples. And we must hold ourselves to the same standards as we do church as a sacred place. You, as a believing Christian, are a living sacred temple. And to give a better example is, K1 is just over here, and everybody knows K1. If they had a big event and they needed overflow space, and they came to Pastor Tony and said, Pastor Tony, so you sort us out on Saturday night, you just let us have this space, we do our thing, would Pastor Tony say yes? Congregation, would he say yes? He would chase them out with security. And I suspect that knowing if people know Pastor Tony, they would not dare ask that question. So the same standards we hold for this place, that there are things that we cannot do in a secret space, are the same standards we should hold to ourselves. We should not be, as it says in the Old Testament, as we are supposed to live our lives as believers and to have a good essence when we are put as a burnt offering. God smells and he says, hey, Githaiga, that, guys, Githaiga is here. He smells good. Don't want it to be, he's like, hey, guy, fungueni dirisha. We must hold ourselves as Christians to very high standards. If you know the activity that you're engaging in, you would not engage here in church under Tony's eye. You should ideally not be engaging in it. And that is the premise of my message today, that as we build this ministry center, as we build this temple, we will also build on ourselves. We will work on ourselves. So as I close, I pray that as this building rises, as this temple rises, day by day, season by season, year by year, every floor it goes, we also grow. As it grows, so do we, so that we shall grow in love, in faith, in joy, in peace, in tolerance, in kindness, in goodness, in faithfulness, gentleness, and in self-control, that we may be truly living sacred temples worthy of the Almighty God. Yeah. Santi. Yeah.
Praise the Lord. Looking at scripture in the eyes of an architect. Interesting, isn't it? When you see God as Father, him, he sees God as a master builder and the awesomeness of creation. Something I'm going to take with me from today is just what he said last. Would K1 ask? You know, if World Cup, you know, the place is jam-packed, so they want to put an extra screen here and tables and a small counter. I don't even think they would agree to come here. They wouldn't agree because it will be what? It will be the secret of this temple because even they respect church. I see how you dress when you come to church, honorably and respectfully. Even how when you walk into church, you know, solemn because you're in the presence of God. Because this building is a house of God, is sacred space. So for sure, if God no longer dwells in temples of stone, but in hearts of flesh, then where are the places that you've been taking this temple? Ask your neighbor, where have you been taking the temple? Yeah, where have you been taking the temple? Yeah, where was the temple last night? Yeah? Or what has been coming into the temple? How many of you watch soccer? I know there are not many hands that will come up. Okay. Okay, maybe I should ask. What were Arsenal wako wapi? What were Man U? Chelsea? Liverpool? What were Abaluya Football Club? Gor Biro. Yeah, one. Are there people from what were Gor wako wapi? When we go to watch soccer, what are those spaces that we take the temple of God for soccer? Just from now on, you know, there are things you hear and you cannot unhear. Because you've already. How do you unhear what you've heard today? So when there's soccer, when there's a soccer match and you want to go in, and as you're walking in, you remember, this is a temple. And you're looking at where you're standing in the door and you're wondering, oh my God, sasitaona hii game. You mean I won't watch this game? Because you are at the entrance of a club and you're wondering, am I taking this temple into the club? And this is the temple of God. And some of you will have to come to a place where you make certain drastic decisions where at that entrance, everyone is walking in, but you will walk away. Why? Because you have a responsibility to this temple that is God's. Because God dwells in us. God dwells in us. In Jesus' name. May the Lord have mercy. And that has hit home. Yeah, that has hit home. Because yesterday, we were going somewhere for a function. And there were two places. The petrol station was slightly farther, but the club was near. So we needed to go to the washroom. So maybe this sermon would have been on Friday. Because I dragged the tempo into the club. You know those things that you tell yourself? Even Jesus would understand. I am pressed. But if I had just walked slightly farther, I would have gone to the petrol station. So that. And when you look at yourself, for sure, God did a good job. He created us well. We are fearfully and wonderfully made. And he dwells in temples that are fearfully and wonderfully made. May we take good care of the temples that God has given us. Where we go, what we say, even in terms of health-wise, even what you put in. What you put in. May the Lord have mercy on us. In Jesus' name. So thank you, Engineer Githaiga. We bless the Lord for the building month, and it has been a blessing. Has it been a blessing? Why don't we appreciate the building month? Seeing the word of God in a different light, in the eyes of different people who might not necessarily be theologians. And I want to say this disclaimer. I don't think it was necessary for you to say if you say something that is not theological. I think they did a very good job. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So it's also a blessing for me to receive. Even me, I'm blessed. And I thank God for his grace. So thank you all. Bwana wabariki. And for those who have children doing exams, let me ask the other parents who don't have children who are doing exams, if also you can take some time to pray for those who are sitting for the exams. And I pray that as parents, it's important to push your children, but push them with wisdom. It is in this generation that children are committing suicide when they fail their exams. It has become so competitive. It has become so unreal. And I want us to pray for a few minutes that this year, after the exams, we will not have children committing suicide. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. It breaks my heart. How far had you pushed this child? I think it's becoming unrealistic. We are commercializing. I see buses now, school buses, that are putting marks of the top student in their school. It's a marketing thing. Now the buses, and then they have written here, 451. And then there's another bus for another school. They have put the marks in front. And you know, if success in life was 451, There are people here who would be chokoraz. Hallelujah. There is more to life, and I'm glad that the teenagers and the youth are not here. There is more to life than those grades. And you know that by now. Hallelujah. You know that by? There is more to life than those grades. Education in itself is a vehicle that helps you. You go to school so you think, you have capacity to think, to make decisions. It's a tool you use in life. How many of you, when you went to work, you didn't write a CV, you took your result slip? You went to a HR office, Devi, and you presented. You got straight A's. HR, you're sitting there with people on the same line and you're just laughing. And then you walk in and you present to the team. You photocopied result slip. Straight A's, all of them. If a guy did that, would they get the job? But they got straight A's, Bana. And straight A's are not for everyone, amen? How come they wouldn't get the job? So there's more to it than just an A. Hallelujah. There's more to it than just an A. And I'm not saying A's are bad. They are very good. They are very, very good. I look forward to see them in my children's. Yeah, even me, when I'm in Bible school and I'm doing exams, I look forward to that A. When I see it, I bless the Lord quietly. Father, thank you in Jesus' name. Bless the Lord. They are not bad. But let us not push our children to feel like without an A, they are failures in life. And that's why children are committing suicide. And I think that's sin. Because there is more to life. There is more to life. Let us raise our children with balance. Push them to succeed in education, but there is more to it than that. Even if when they don't bring an A, they are still your children. If my son doesn't bring an A, he's still my son. And I'm still proud of him. Hallelujah. You see the way it's quiet? See the way it's quiet? But it's true. All of you here, and some of you here, let me say, all of you here have succeeded in one way or the other. True? But not all of you made A's. Not all of you made A's. And for those of you who made A's, I hope and pray that you are making good use of it. I hope you didn't just take it and throw it in the drawer, because it's a gift from God. I hope that if you are an A student, that one day you go back to school, do a master's, do a PhD, and teach. God didn't just give you that brain to put it in a drawer. And if that is you, repent. In Jesus' name. Use those brains to teach others. Hallelujah. Yeah. You can see the way amen zinatoka. Si nyingi ni watu wa sindi wanasema amen. Watu wae wamenyamaza. Awataki kurudi shule. And maybe it's the Holy Spirit that is speaking. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. It is the Holy Spirit that is speaking. Go back to school. God didn't give you an amazing brain for nothing. God doesn't waste things. Kuna watu Mungu angepatia hizo brains, lakini akakataa. Watu wengine wangepewa hizo akili, sijui tungekuwa tunapitia wapi. May the Lord have mercy on us. May the Lord have mercy on us. We complain about what the university is churning out, but university shapes a mind. If you don't like what you're seeing coming out of the university, go back to school, do a master's, do a PhD, then eventually write a few papers, get a job, teach part-time, and influence those minds for Christ. Fold your sleeves and go to work. We become the change we want to see. In Jesus' name. I think it's Winston Churchill that said that. Is that true? Be the change you want to see. Fold your sleeves and go to work. God didn't give you an amazing mind for nothing. It must count for something. Go back to school. Study and use it. In Jesus' name. Me, everything God gave me, I have exhausted. I have used completely in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. The abilities that God gave me, I have used completely. I have used mine. I hope that you will say the same for yourself in Jesus' name. So I love you as your pastor. May the Lord continue to see you through, and may the Lord fight for us in Jesus' name. And it's good to see Rosemary and Parashina. I bless the Lord. Those things, they bless my heart. When I see a man like that who's being harassed by the three-year-old, status or no, these three-year-olds don't care. He's running all over the curve, Brovuko, running behind. Hata hakusikia neno. Three-year-old don't care. May we raise a generation that loves the Lord. Let's stand on our feet as we conclude. For Judy Manoj and Blossom Sadiq, we love you. And may the Lord continue to wipe your tears. May the Lord continue to encourage you. And we love you as a church. And when one heart's here, we all heart. Amen? Hallelujah. And I have a prayer request. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. When there is peace in Jerusalem, there is peace in the Middle East. Directly proportionate. When there is peace in Jerusalem, there will be peace in the Middle East. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray that the Church of Jesus Christ today will be a vehicle for peace. And we pray for the peace of Jerusalem, that there shall be peace in the Middle East. And God, we are reminding you today that you promised Abraham. Remember the promise to Abraham. Remember the promise to your friend. I pray that you remember every home here. I speak life over every home. I pray, Almighty God, that during these economic difficulties, O Lord, that you remember every home. The Lord, may you multiply that which comes to our hands. I pray, Almighty God, that there will be no stress and pressure in our homes. The Lord, you would minister to our hearts. Remember our children. O God Almighty, we speak peace in our homes and healing that comes from thee. Bless the works of our hands, Almighty God. Bless our minds. And I pray that at night when we sleep, God, I pray for the gift of sleep. That everyone here will sleep sound at night. Sleep such that our bodies will have peace and our hearts. The Lord, there will be no pressure. There will be a distinction between us and the rest in the world, that we shall sleep at night. God Almighty, that which we touch, may it prosper. I ask that all of us lift our hands to God. Father, these hands that are lifted to you, I pray that you will bless that which these hands touch. Bless the works of each of these hands. And may the works of these hands bring you honor and glory. For we pray this because we believe and trust in Jesus' name. As you live today, may the Lord shine his face upon each one of you. May his favor, may the favor of God be evident over your life. May none of your bones ever be broken. May what is yours that the devil has taken or touched, may our God in heaven restore to you 100-fold. May the peace of God, that surpasses human understanding, fill your hearts. And may the joy of the Lord be your portion. May that joy fill and saturate every inch of your home. Remember, you have the power of life and death on your tongue. So choose to declare life over every aspect of your life, over the nation of Kenya, over the nation of Israel, and as the Lord may lead you. And on every road you travel on, declare on this road today, no one will lose their life or have their property destroyed. And now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. As you remain standing, I have a request. We have a family here from West Africa that speaks French. And their children go to children's church. So they don't understand English. They are learning English. If you're here, of course you're here. And you speak French. Anyone here who speaks French, we would invite you to join children's church and help translate the lessons for those children. They are assemblies of God from West Africa. They've come here, but they are learning English, but they speak French. If you speak French, please see Teacher Beatrice at the back and volunteer and help translate what the teachers are saying into French. In Jesus' name, go with God. Amen.